Good afternoon, friends. We are learning our subject that is data mining 3160714. And in that, we are learning our chapter 2 that is data pre-processing. So let us see the recall of our last lecture so we can have the idea what we have studied. In the previous lecture, we have learned what? That was the transformation methods, right? Transformation methods. For that, what we have seen? Winning method we have seen. That was for discretization, isn't it? So discretization methods and transformations methods we have seen. So what we have seen, just look at that. We have seen the smoothing methods and transformation. For that, we have seen min max normalization, then z score method, then after normalization by decimal scaling, then after discretization, we have started with, we have made the groups, then after we can say what we have done, that is binning method we have seen, right? The example also we have seen for that, that is for equal weight partitioning and equal depth partitioning. So now let us see the discretization by classification and correlation analysis. Okay, so classification, do we know about that? We only know that it is supervised, that is the class labels are given, as for example cancerous, or you can say that these are the intelligent students, these are the poor students, or you can say you can have the different groups, right? But those groups are already given the labels, right? So whenever we are talking of the classification, that means the class labels are given using entropy to determine split point, that is the discretization point. Just now you do not have the idea of classification, that we will study in next chapter. Okay, so at that time we'll see the classification methods, right? That is the discretization point that we will see in those particular algorithms. Okay, so how the discretization is done using the correlation analysis? For that, we can say it is supervised. So it uses the class information, bottom up and merge. Find the best neighboring intervals. Those have similar distributions of classes, that is low chi square values, right? Low chi square values to merge, and merge is performed recursively until a predefined stopping condition is there, right? Now next thing which we want to learn in data pre-processing, that is data reduction. We know that we are having a big, or you can say large amount of data. On that, we want to apply the algorithms and we want to get the results, right? So for that, if the data is large, whatever algorithm we apply on that, that will take more time, isn't it? So what should we do is, we should reduce the data. So that is the simple thing, or you can say that it is a requirement or need of data reduction. So what do we say is, data reduction is the process of minimizing the amount of data. Need of data reduction. So for that, as we have talked, the data warehouses store terabytes or petabytes bytes of data. Complex data analysis may take very long time to run for complete data set. sorry, if the data is reduced to a small amount that can produce same or almost same analytical results, that is preferable, right? So let me say that this is the requirement of data reduction algorithm. What do we mean to say is, if we apply any data reduction algorithm, it should give us same or almost same analytical results, then only data reduction technique is acceptable, right? So take care of that. Whenever you are applying data reduction, it should give almost same or same analytical results. So now, which type of reductions we are having? That is the types of reduction. So for that, we can say here in this figure, we can see three types of reductions are there. One is case reduction. Here we can see that is the number of rows we are trying to reduce. Number of rows we are trying to reduce. Feature reduction. That is, we can say number of columns we are trying to reduce. That is, you can say whatever features we already have, from that either we select whatever is required or we may construct new feature based on the available features, right? The third type of reduction is value reduction. That is, whatever is the value available, that will reduce. Let us say that the value is say 1000, we'll make it say 10, right? So we'll use the normalization for that, fine. So data reduction types, in general, when we are talking of, they are of three types. One is case reduction, that is the number of rows we are trying to reduce. When we say that the number of columns we are trying to reduce, that is called the feature reduction. And when we are trying to reduce a number value, that is called the value reduction. So what do we say is feature reduction? That means the columns we are trying to reduce. We may combine two or more features, or otherwise we'll consider only the required features for a particular decision, right? Case reduction, that is the number of rows we are trying to reduce, fine. So how we can say, how we can do that? We can consider the sampling for that, or otherwise we may consider the redundant data removal, fine. We may consider the redundant data removal. So either we consider the sampling, or you can say the redundant data removal, we will be able to have the case reduction, fine. For value reduction, as we have talked of, the values which it is taking for that will reduce that value, fine. And what we do for that, that reduction, for this value reduction methods, they can be the rounding or k-means clustering and discretization using entropy minimization. Fine. So these are the ways to get the value reduction. So what are the data reduction strategies? For that, we can say data cube aggregation, attributed subset selection, numerosity reduction, dimensionality reduction, discretization, and concept hierarchy generation. So for that, we want to know all these methods or strategies, right? So what do we say about dimensionality reduction? It is a process of reducing the number of random variables under consideration via obtaining a set of principal variables. It can be divided into feature selection and feature extraction. The advantages of the dimensionality reduction are It reduces the time and storage required. Removal of the multi-collinearity improves the performance of the machine learning model. It becomes easier to visualize the data when reduced to very low dimensions, such as 2D or 3D. So let us consider what are these data reduction, the numericity reduction, and what are the ways, what are the methods to do all those things. Fine. So for that, data reduction, about that, what do we say is obtain a reduced presentation of the data set that is much smaller in volume, but yet produces the same or almost same analytical result. That is what should be there in our mind, right? Why data reduction? That is, a database data warehouse may store terabytes of data. Complex data analysis may take a very long time to run on the complete data set. So what are the strategies for data reduction? For dimensionality reduction, we can say that remove the unimportant attributes. So for that, the methods which people are using, they are the wavelet transforms, then principal component analysis, principal, we can say principal component analysis, then feature subset selection. We may be having, say, hundreds of features in the database or data warehouse, but we'll select required features for that particular decision. We may create new features based on the available features, right? To reduce the features, isn't it? So that is the dimensionality reduction, numericity reduction, right? Or many times people call it as only the data reduction. For that, we can be using the regression or log linear models, histogram, clustering, sampling. These things are also useful for numericity reduction. It uses data cube aggregation too, right? See, data cube aggregation, that means you can say that many numbers are there for your particular class. Okay, say each and every person is having some percentage. So if I want to get the aggregate value of your class, what I'll do is I'll take the aggregate value, or you can say average value of your percentage, isn't it? So number of values were there, but we have reduced it to one particular value, right? So that is aggregation. And for data cube, we are doing that. Data compression, that is also the method to reduce the data. And for that, we can say we can be having string compression, image compression, video compression, isn't it? Compression is already known to us. We are using compression in our operating system utilities, where you can say that we are compressing so many files are there in the folder, and we are compressing that. We can be creating the zip, or you can say RAR, or you can say tar file as in Linux, right? So data reduction, for that, let us consider the dimensionality reduction. Dimensionality reduction is what? It is where we are trying to reduce the features, isn't it? So we can say we are trying to reduce the columns. We are trying to reduce the columns, isn't it? Okay, so first of all, we want to know curse of dimensionality, what it is. When dimensionality increases, data becomes increasingly sparse. Density and distance between points, which is critical to clustering, outlier analysis becomes less meaningful. The possible combinations of subspaces will grow exponentially, right? So dimensionality reduction does what? It avoids the curse of dimensionality, what we have just talked of. It helps us eliminate irrelevant features and reduces the noise. It reduces the time and space required in data mining. It allows easier visualization, right? So the techniques, they are the wavelet transform, principal component analysis, supervised and nonlinear techniques, let us say that feature selection. Let us consider the data compression. For that, we can say that string compression, audio and video compression, time sequence is not audio, all these things we are doing, right? So what do we say about string compression? For that, there are extensive theories and well-tuned algorithms are available, typically lossless, but only limited manipulation is possible without expansion. Audio or video compression, typically lossy. String compression is lossless. No loss is there in that. And audio video, for that we can say typically, that is in general it is lossy compression, but there can be the algorithm where it can be lossless, right? With progressive refinement, sometimes small fragments of signal can be reconstructed without reconstructing the whole. Fine. Time sequence is not audio, so we are considering that over here in audio and video. No, we are not considering it over there. So what do we consider for time sequence? Typically short and very slowly with time. Dimensionality and numerosity reduction may also be considered as forms of data compression. Fine. So what is the difference between dimensionality reduction and numerosity reduction? Dimensionality reduction means you are reducing the number of dimensions, that is features of the data. In other words, it might be feature reduction or you can say feature selection. In numerosity reduction, the original data set is replaced by an alternate and smaller data representation, right? So let us see the data compression. Say original data is there, then you can say that the compressed data is there with whatever algorithm we are using. If it is lossless, then from the compressed data, we'll be able to get the original data. If it is lossy, then we will be able to get original data approximated, right? Not 100% original data, but we can be having the approximated original data, right? So now we want to know the techniques. So for that, we have considered attribute subset selection. That is way to reduce the dimensionality of the data. Redundant attributes duplicate much or all of the information contained in one or more other attributes. As for example, purchase price of a product and the amount of sales tax paid. So that is one way, redundant attribute removal, isn't it? Second way is irrelevant attributes. What does that mean? It contains no information that is useful for the data mining task at hand. As for example, student's ID often is irrelevant task of predicting student's GPA, right? So for that, we can say we'll not consider student ID for this particular decision task. Are you getting that? For attribute, subset, selection, we are using say two ways which we just discussed. They are redundant attributes removal and we can say irrelevant attributes removal, right? Removal means we can say that for further processing will not consider those data. Fine. Heuristic search in attribute selection. What is that? There are 2D possible attribute combinations of D attributes. Typical heuristic attribute selection methods. What are they? Best single attribute under the attribute independence assumption. Choose by the significance test. Second way is best stepwise feature selection. That is, the best single attribute is picked first. Then, next best attribute condition to the first. Then after, the third one is stepwise attribute elimination. That is, repeatedly eliminate the worst attributes. Then, best combined attribute selection and elimination. That is, whatever best we consider, we combine them and eliminate which are not contributing to the best attribute. Fine? Optimal branch and bound. Use attribute elimination and backtracking. Now, next way is attribute creation. By that also, we can have the attribute. Or you can say data reduction, in that particularly dimensionality reduction. Fine. So, what do we consider here is create new attributes that can capture the important information in a data set more effectively than the original ones. Three general methodologies for that. One is attribute extraction, which is domain specific. If I want to have the data related to, say, computer engineering, I will extract the data. I will extract the features where it is specific to that particular domain. I'll not consider for others, right? A simple example we can say. Second one is mapping data to a new space. That is what? That is, we can say, as for example, to Fourier transform. We can say wavelet transform. We are mapping the data to new particular space, right? Using say Fourier transformation or wavelet transformation or manifold approaches. Fine. Then we can have the attribute construction, that is using combining the features. We can have say 2-3 attributes, like you can say that your subject marks, subject 1 marks, subject 2 marks, subject 3 marks. What we do is, instead of considering the marks of each and every subject, what we will do is, we'll combine that. Now you can say how to combine. Let us consider the percentage of all the subjects, isn't it? So we'll be having one feature that represents all the subject attributes, that is subject marks attributes, isn't it? So this is also the way That is attribute construction that is from the available features will combine them to have a new attribute, right? Data discretization is also useful for attribute construction, fine. Now we want to know about the compression algorithms. So first of all, let us consider this string compression algorithm. For that, let us see one algorithm is run, length, and coding. What is that? It is one of the string compression algorithms. Now, what is there in that algorithm? That is, if a character, any character, so I am writing it as CH in the braces, right, occurs for n greater than 1 times in a row, then it will be represented by, in the braces, CH. Whatever is the character, if it is A, then we are writing it A, right? So you can say in the braces that, and then after its occurrence, that is, or you can say count. So that is, say, CH of N, right? For example, if the substring is a sequence of A, that is, say, A, 4 times A is available, it will be represented as A4, right? It will be represented as A4 because A is available 4 times, right? The character is A and the count of that, or you can say that it occurs 4 times, right? If a character occurs exactly 1 time in a row, then it will be simply represented as, inside the braces, CH, right? That is, you can say if A is there, then you can say only A. We do not have to write it as A1, right? Because what we have considered is, if the character occurs for greater than 1, right? Then only we'll write it as A2 or A4 or C4 or whatsoever, right? Let's see the example, we can have the idea. Say, sample input for the string is given, that is, ABC, AAA, BBB. Now, what should be the output of this string compression run length and coding algorithm? That is, we can say ABC, because these three characters are available once only. Now, you can say, but if we find the count of A, then it is 1, 2, 3, 4. You can say this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. For B, if we say, then that is also available 1, 2, 3, 4 times. So shouldn't we write it as A4, B4? No. See, the way the sequence is there, that is important here, right? What we said is, if the substring is a sequence of something, right? Sequence is important. Not only the count, but where it is available in the sequence. For that, we have to consider the occurrence. So here we can say this AAA, they are available in the sequence and occurs 3 times. For that, we can write it as A3. For this B also, BBB, they occur in sequence and they are available 3 times. So it is B3. Fine. Now, if the input is ABCD, you can say here, the occurrence of each and every character is once only. So its output will be ABCD, isn't it? Its output will be ABCD because each and every character in this particular string is available once only in the sequence. Fine. So the same will be the output. If the input is, say, AAAB, AAAA, A, C, C, A. Now what should we replace for this particular string? That is, what is the compressed string for this particular string? So for that we can say A3, because A is available 3 times, then B, then A4, then C2, then A4, then B, and then A, right? So we count the occurrence in the sequence, and whatever is that, that will be the compressed string for whatever is the input given, right? So that's what is available as the sample output. Very simple algorithm, isn't it? This algorithm I have shown you to make you understand what is string comparison. Sorry, compression. Data reduction. We want to know about the numerosity reduction. What is that? We have already talked of, isn't it? Let us see the methods for it. It reduces the data volume by choosing alternative smaller forms of data representation. So what are the methods for doing numerosity reduction? That is parametric methods and non-parametric methods. So what are they? Assume data fits some model. When we say parametric, it means that we are assuming the data fits some model. Estimate model parameters. Store only the parameters and discard the data, right? And discard the data. As for example, regression. And what are the models we can consider? That is log linear models. Obtains the value at a point in n-dimensional space as the product on appropriate marginal subspaces, right? So what about the non-parametric methods? They do not assume the models. They do not assume the models. Fine. These methods are used for storing reduced representations of the data, and in that measure families, they are having histograms, clustering, sampling, isn't it? For parametric data reduction, we say that it is having regression and log linear models. Fine. So for regression, we used to say it is having the linear regression, multiple regression, and then after we can say that we are having log linear model, isn't it? So for that, what is seed for linear regression? That is data modeled to fit a straight line, right? We have already studied the linear regression. That is why here I am saying in small, that is linear regression. For that, we are modeling the data to fit a straight line. It often uses least square method to fit the line, isn't it? Multiple regression. It allows a response variable y to be modeled as linear function of multidimensional feature vector. What about the log linear model? It approximates discrete multidimensional probability distributions. So for regression analysis, a collective name for techniques for the modeling and analysis of numerical data consisting of a dependent variable. That is called the response variable or measurement, and one or more independent variables. That is, you can say, also known as the explanatory variables. Fine. Or people say it as predictors also. The parameters are estimated so as to give a best fit of the data. Most commonly, the best fit is evaluated by using the least square method. But other criteria have also been used, right? It is useful for prediction. It is useful for prediction, including forecasting of time series data, inference, hypothesis testing, and modeling of causal relationships, right? So we can use the regression for dimension reduction. How we do that? Regression is useful for residual analysis, which is when subtracted the fitted line from the data and plot the residuals to try to detect patterns, right? These residuals can be thought of as dimension of data, and we can get information by inspecting it. Similarly, the regressed lines also gives insight about the data, in that it shows the general trend of the data. When perform dimensionality reduction using principal component analysis, the cost function to find the first principal component is similar to the cost function used when we do the linear regression. So those lines should be fairly close for well-behaved data, right? We use linear regression to do dimension reduction, in particular to obtain the residual dimension, okay? So, regression analysis and log linear models. What is there in linear regression? That is y is equal to, say, wx plus b. Two regression coefficients are there. They are the w and b. Specify the line and are to be estimated by using the data at hand. Using the least squares criterion to know values, they are y1, y2, x1, x2, right? So what do we say about the multiple regression? That is, for that the equation is y is equal to b0 plus b1 x1 plus b2 x2, right? Here we are having more x variables. In the first one, that is linear regression, over there we were having only one x, but now here for multiple regression, we are having the multiple x, that is x1, x2, right? Many nonlinear functions can be transformed into the above equation. What do we say about the log linear models? So we say that it approximates the discrete multidimensional probability distributions. It estimates the probability of each point in multidimensional space for a set of discretized attributes based on a smaller subset of dimensional combinations. It is useful for dimensionality reduction, and data smoothing. So if we want to have the multiple regression example, here we can say that independent variable they are given, then regression coefficient is there, t value is there, and p value is there, right? This is what is given here. Now, as we know that y is equal to v0 plus v1x1 plus v2x2, right? So here we are having, say, age as the continuous attribute, that is in years. Here it is, right? Then after male, for gender, that is yes or no. Then after treatment for hypertension, yes or no, are the potential co-founders, and if so, appropriately account for this using multiple linear regression. What we consider is, for treatment for hypertension is coded as 1 or 0. That means whether that person needs to have the treatment or not, right? For what? For hypertension, because this is the example for it. Fine. Now, for our consideration, 1 is for male, that is male gender we have considered, right? So if we consider male is equal to 1, that means a person is male, and if that is equal to 0, that means a person is female, right? So from this particular table, we want to find whether the person needs to have treatment or not. Fine. So how we can have the equation, that is for a multiple regression, that is we can say y is equal to y hat, that is a predicted one, right? Y hat, that is equal to what is the 68.15, that is the intercept, right? The data is already given to us, fine. Now 0.58, that is a regression coefficient for BMI, right? So 0.58 into BMI, because what we are considering in the equation, that is y is equal to b0, that is the intercept, plus b1x1 plus b2x2, right? So for each and every variable, what we have to consider is the coefficient and whatever is the name of it, right? So 0.58 BMI, then we can say 0.65 age, then 0.94, that is 94, or say 0.946, something is that. Then we can consider it as 0.95, right? 0.9468, something is that. So we have considered it as 0.95, right? Or you can see here 0.94, so you can write that also over here, no issue. Then 6.44, then treatment for hypertension, right? So this is what is the equation for us, that is for y is equal to b0 plus b1x1 plus b2x2. You can see only two variables are there. See, if many variables, like here we can say BMI, age, then we can say male gender, right? So many variables are there, right? Treatment for hypertension, all those things are there. What we have to consider is, we have to consider this particular equation, fine? This is the intercept, this is for BMI coefficient, this is for age coefficient, this is for male gender coefficient, and this is what we can say is treatment for hypertension coefficient. Which coefficient? Regression coefficient, right? Have we found that? It is already there with us, okay? It is given in the problem statement. So now, what do we want to find is, men have higher systolic blood pressures by approximately 0.94 units, holding BMI, age, and treatment for hypertension constant, and persons on treatment for hypertension have higher systolic blood pressures by approximately 6.44 units, holding BMI, age, and gender constant, right? The multiple regression equation can be used to estimate blood pressures as a function of participants' BMI, age, gender, and treatment for hypertension status, right? This is what we have already seen, isn't it? This is what we have already seen in the tabular format, right? For your explanation, I'm reading again so we can see this particular equation, fine. Now, in that equation, what we have seen already there, this particular equation, this is where we have only written BMI, age, male gender, and treatment for hypertension. That is what is given in this particular table, right? Now, what we are doing is, now in this, we want to estimate the blood pressure for 50-year male. What is that 50-year? That is age. So wherever the age is there, in that, for that age word, we'll put the data. That is a 50. What we want to predict, right? We want to predict for, say, male of 50 years, then BMI of 25, who is not on treatment for hypertension. So for that, we need to put the values inside the equation. That was y is equal to b0 plus b1x1 plus b2x2, right? And for that, what we have considered is this particular equation, right? So in this equation, whatever is the conditions we have just given, those values will be putting here, right? For male gender, if you want to find for 50-year male, you can say for age, we have to put it as 50. For male gender, we'll be putting it as 1. Because for male, it is 1 and for female, it is 0, right? Treatment for hypertension, whatever is the value given, that we have to put here, right? And whatever is there for BMI, that also we have to put in this particular equation, fine. So what we are getting for that, that is, we can say 68.15, that was the intercept given, then 0.58 into 25. What is that? That is BMI, which is given here, right? In the problem statement, that we want to estimate the data for 50-year-old male. Male, that means male gender, and that is equal to 1, right? So 0.94 into 1. Then who is not on treatment? See, if a person is there on the treatment, we consider it as 1, value as 1. And the person is not on the treatment, and we consider the value as 0, right? So 6.66 inside the 0, fine. So that is equal to, what we are getting is 116.1, right? So what do we predict is the blood pressure of whom? Of 50-year-old male, BMI is 25, and who is not on treatment, right? So for that, we have predicted the blood pressure, right? Same way, if we are having 50-year-old female with BMI of 25, who is on treatment, for we can say that we want to find the hypertension. So what to do? 25 is the age, 25 is the BMI, 50 year is the age, then after, what we want is on the treatment. So for that, the value is 1, and person is female. So we need to consider it as 0, right? For male gender variable, we'll be considering it as 0, right? So we can see the equation. What is there for it? We can say 68.15 plus 0.58 into 25, that is BMI, 0.65 into 50, that is age, plus 0.94 into 0, that is for male gender, female, plus 6.44 into 1, that is a person is on the treatment for hypertension. And what value we are getting, that is 1 to 1.59, that is predicted or estimated blood sugar for whom? For 50-year-old female with BMI of 25 who is on the treatment for hypertension, right? So this example very clearly says that how to calculate it. Fine. So next method which we want to know is the histogram analysis. So divide the data into buckets and store average or sum for each bucket, right? For that, the partitioning rules are equal width, that is equal bucket range, and equal frequency or equal depth. Most of the times people are using equal width binning and equal frequency binning before applying this histogram, right? That is, we partition the data and then after we can have the frequency count in that particular bucket, right? So this way it is being represented, and that is the histogram analysis. Fine. This binning example we already have seen. Let us just check it out. This is the data given, right? It must be there in the sorted manner for binning algorithm. Fine. So if it is equal width algorithm, what do we know is we should have the width available. Fine. So what we say is, what is the width? That is 28 maximum minus 0, that is a minimum, divided by whatever is the width, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Divide by total number of numbers, right? Count. I mean, whatever number of data is available, right? So for that, what we have considered? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? So 28 minus 0 divided by 9, right? So that's what we are considering. So here, what do we say? Now in how many beans we want to divide the data? That is 3. The number of beans we want to consider is 3. 9 was the total numbers. What do we want to do is, we want to have the 3 beans. So we'll be dividing the data. That is 28 minus 0 divided by, when we are saying the 9, you can see that we want to have the 3 beans. But now if we divide it by 3, we can say that we will be having the width as 9, right? 28 minus 0 divided by 3, 3 number of beans. So we'll be having the 9 point something. So we'll be taking the width as 0 to 10, right? 0 to 10, or typically people are writing it as negative to 10. That means negative infinity to plus 10. But that 10 is excluded, isn't it? Now when we are dividing it in the beans, that is, we can say that we'll be putting the values 0 and 4, because that only comes in the range of 0 to 10 for this particular interval. For this 10 to 20, whatever is the numbers available that we have written, then for 22 plus, that also for that we have put the numbers. So what is the count of it? For this particular bean, we are having 2 numbers. So frequency is 2. For this particular, we are having 4 numbers. So count is 4. For the third bean, we are having the count is equal to 3, right? So we can say for equal weight, we can put the histogram as say 0 to 2. That is, you can say for bean 1, this is for bean 2, and this is for bean 3. Same way, we'll be having the binning algorithm for equal frequency, and we'll find the count. So 3, 3, and 3. Now, remember one thing. Equal frequency binning, that means in a bean, it is having equal numbers, right? And for that, we'll be having the equal, you can say, height, right? It is having equal height, right? So always remember this thing. Such example can be asked to you in the exam. That is, do the binning, that is using equal width or equal frequency, and then after draw the histogram, right? We know that histogram is useful for doing the discretization also, fine? So that's all for today.